Okay, now I have the pleasure to introduce Professor Domokos Csás from the Hungarian Academy of Science, and he will talk about stochastic dynamics issued from a deterministic one.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the invitation to this very interesting. Okay, so thank you very much for this very interesting event. I'm enjoying both the school and the conference. So this is the title of my talk, and my co-authors are there. So the goal is to derive the heat equation from microscopic principles. So this is the well-known heat equation, where there is a constant C, which is the specific heat, and kappa is the thermal conductivity, and kappa depends on the temperature, and for different materials, the dependence on the temperature is different. For a wide class of models, the dependence is square root of the temperature. For example, there are some examples, insulating materials, gases of weakly or rarely interacting particles. Now, Bonetto, Lebovitz, and Ray Bialet wrote a survey about the progress in the derivation of the heat equation, and they were emphasizing that it would be necessary to add interaction between the moving particles. Instead of points, make them little balls. In fact, there are two competing types of models where people, mathematicians and physicists, try to derive the heat equation from microscopic principles: billiard-like models and nonlinear oscillators, interacting nonlinear oscillators. In the mathematical theory for nonlinear oscillators, to treat the model, one always has to introduce some small stochastic noise. For billiard models, there is a hope that one can avoid this, one can really address the deterministic evolution. Now, there have been results where one could obtain the diffusion equation, the Brownian motion from microscopic principles, well known the Lorentz process, Bunyimovich and Sinai, and later Bunyimovich and Chernov-Sinai. But there was always only one particle and no interacting particles. So Gaspar and Gilbert, two Belgian physicists, in 2008, were suggesting a model of localized hard disk or hard spheres, and my talk will be very strongly related to their method. So what they were doing, that they introduced this model of localized hard disks. I will, of course, explain what they had in mind. And the approach was the following. So you start from the microscopic kinetic equation, the full description of the system of this is the Hamiltonian model, of course, and then from the microscopic model you take a rare interaction limit, and in this rare but strong interaction limit they obtain a stochastic process, a generator of a Markov jump process. The kinetic equation is related to the full phase description, all the positions and velocities of the particles. In the Markov jump process, you lose a lot of information. The equation, the stochastic process, is only related to the energies of the particle. That's a mesoscopic picture. And then in the second step from this Markov jump process, they hope to derive the macroscopic heat equation. Now, the model is the following. The Gaspard-Gilbert model is the following. Well, on this picture, you see a chain of lengths 2, but of course, you can imagine arbitrary lengths. It's a quasi-linear model, so a chain of particles. So the shaded domains, they are fixed periodic scatterers. And the white disks, white circles, they are the moving particles. And I will explain it later more precisely, but the parameters of the model are determined in such a way that these disks can interact with each other, neighboring disks, but they cannot leave their cells. So in this sense, they are localized. This simplifies the situation. Well, the model has even physically some meaning. So in this physical paper, they were just using a model, so a situation where there was no mass transport, only energy transport. Okay, so this model is a semi-dispersing billiard. I will be more precise again. So just a very brief introduction into the notions which I am going to use. So this is the well-known Sinai billiard. So you are on the torus. You have, in this case, one scatterer, and the dynamics is uniform motion and specular elastic reflection. And then, of course, you take into account the geometry of the torus. So this is a two-dimensional Sinai billiard. I will talk about the billiard flow and the so-called billiard ball map. So the billiard flow is the continuous time evolution. It has an invariant measure, the alluvial measure. So the phase space is the billiard table in dimension D. It's a subset of the D-dimensional torus. On the picture, it's two-dimensional. And for the velocities, you have the D minus one sphere. And the discrete map can be obtained in the following way. So there, the phase space is the boundary of the billiard table. So in this case, the boundary of this scatterer. And again, the velocity space is the same. So well-known definitions. So a billiard is called dispersing or Sinai billiard if these scatterers, the fixed scatterers, are strictly convex, and semi-dispersing if they are just convex. Now, the parameter choice of Gaspard and Gilbert was the following. So the box size is 1, chain length n, on my picture it was 2. Then along the vertical axis, the y-axis, you take periodic boundary conditions for simplicity. And this is a notation. The radius of the fixed scatterers, which were the shaded circles, rho f, and of the moving disk, rho m. And there is a condition of confinement, very simple geometry, that the two radii add up more than 1/2. And also, there is a condition that the two neighboring disks can interact at all. So there is a critical value when they can only touch each other. There is no interaction. And if the radius of the moving scatterer is a bit higher, then you already have really interaction. It's natural to introduce a small parameter, which is how much you are above the critical value for the moving, for the radius of the moving disk. And what Gaspard and Gilbert were doing, they were keeping the sum of the two radii fixed. And then essentially the phase spaces, the configuration spaces of this neighboring disk, essentially depend only on rho, on the sum. And if you are just at the critical, then you have n non-interacting billiard balls. So that's their model. Now, this is a sort of physical formulation of the kinetic equation. It was already derived. It's very simple. It was derived already in 89 by Ernst and Dorfman. So this is the complete time evolution of the density in terms of the configuration points and the velocities of the particles. And then the time derivative is the sum of three terms. First of all, there is free motion. There is the wall collisions of each particles. And there are the binary collisions of neighboring particles. I took this equation because I will need the notation for the wall collision rate, which I denote by nu wall epsilon, and the binary collision rate, which I denote by nu bin epsilon. And, oops. Yeah. So, and when this epsilon, my small parameter, tends to zero, there is a natural scale separation. Namely, the wall collision rate converges to some positive constant, of course, because you can imagine that the particles, the disk collide with the wall a lot of time before two neighboring walls collide. And if epsilon tends to zero, then the binary collision rate tends to zero. Right? So there are two scales, one for the wall collisions and one for the binary collisions. Now, what Gaspar and Gilbert did in this limit transition, they derived a so-called master equation, so the generator of this Markov jump process, which I will be talking about, which was, as I said, an equation for the energies, the time evolution of the energies, and then they realized the hydrodynamic limit, so from this master equation they obtained the heat equation, and they also obtained the coefficient of heat conductivity for this model. As I said, it was constant times square root of T. So this is just a repetition of what I already said, that the mesoscopic equation is a Markov jump process. So, just a small remark that as to the second part, so the first part is dynamical system problem. The second part is a probability problem. From the Markov jump process, one has to derive the heat equation, taking the hydrodynamic limit in the sense of Varadhan. The first starting step we made with Alex Grigu and Kostya Hanin, we proved some bound for the spectral gap as n, the chain length, increases. Sasada improved our result by having found optimal conditions for the spectral gap. Sorry. Okay, don't bother about it. And, okay, so now I return to the actual problem for part one from the dynamical system. So that's, of course, a challenging question, and there were at least two interesting results for that. First, Dolgopyat and Liverani introduced a model where the particles had each particle, it was a chain again, each particle had an Anosov dynamics, and the interaction was through a potential which was very weak. So weak interaction acting permanently. And as a result, they could derive the mesoscopic equation, which was, again, a Markov process, but it was a system of interacting differential equations, not jump process, because here the interaction is permanent. Another approach was by Keller and Liverani, who were taking really already the rare interaction limit for a coupled map lattice of interval maps. And they derived, they introduced the interaction in such a way that it was similar to this kind of hardcore interaction. So when the two particles had an interaction, it was drastic, it was very strong. And for this model, they could derive the uniqueness of the SRB state, and they could also prove exponential space-time decay. Now, what I would like to do, I would like to give some idea of our approach, what we have in mind. So the first is a reference to two earlier results. So that is a classical result by Hirata, Sossol, and Vajenti, which is a rather general abstract result. If you have a dynamical system which is mixing in a controlled way, for example, alpha mixing, and you have a sequence of nice subsets to avoid neighbors of periodic points and so on, such that the measures tend to zero, then the successive entrance times of the dynamics into this small set forms a Poisson process in the limit, of course, in the appropriate scaling. That's, I think, intuitively very clear. A more quantitative formulation of this kind of theorem was 2 years ago given by Chazot and Collet. So this is what I said, it's intuitive background. Now I return to the model itself, and now I will only talk about the two, n equals 2 case. So this is a four-dimensional billiard model. The two centers are two-dimensional, so the altogether is four-dimensional. Model is a billiard, it's easy to see. And this model is isomorphic, actually, to a four-dimensional semi-dispersing billiard. Semi-dispersing because the scatterers in the four-dimensional space are cylinders with two-dimensional bases and two-dimensional generator spaces. Now, of course, it would be very nice to apply the theory of hyperbolic billiards if there were such a theory for this case. So what Bunimovic, Liverani, Pellegrini, Suhoff proved in 92, that this model and the N-chain and also a general class of these models are ergodic mixing Kolmogorov, mixing even. But no mixing rate was known. So I remind you that in Hirata, Sossol, Vajenti, first condition was a sort of controlled rate of mixing. This is what is definitely missing here. Now, Peter Bálint and Peter Tóth, also called Mogyoró, in 2008, they proved exponential correlation decay for higher dimensional billiards. Well, those, you may know that for two-dimensional case, exponential decay of correlation was proved by Lai Sang-Yang, but no results exist for higher dimensional case. So this result is the only one, but it's only valid for the finite horizon case. Specific class, I don't go into detail. Dispersing billiards, Sinai billiards. And this theorem uses a so-called complexity hypothesis, which is certainly a fundamental hypothesis in billiard theory. Again, I will not use it, I just mentioned this. Now, our approach is based on the following idea. So there is a a very efficient method for using some Markov property of billiards by Chernov and Dolgopyat. And this method is called the standard bear method. Well, whenever you want to show any statistical or stochastic property of billiards, you use a sort of Markov method, sometimes completed with some martingale ideas, but the essential is the some Markovity. There were Markov partitions, Markov seas, Markov towers, and in this evolution there is the standard pair method, which is probably not so widely known, so I will just spend one slide about showing how this Markovness appears in the standard pair method and what is a standard pair. So the standard pair, so this is a two-dimensional case. So so I'm considering the billiard ball map, two-dimensional billiard, and the standard pair is an unstable curve and a nice probability density on this unstable curve. So that's the standard pair. Now, what you have to imagine that you have this two-dimensional phase space, which is one, this kind of cylinder, or several of them. And you cover your whole phase space with a family, of course, uncountable family, of standard pairs. This is a proper family. Now, if you take a standard pair wherever from this family, and you apply the dynamics. I said that the standard pair, the first component is an unstable curve. So for the dynamic x, that it increases. There is a sort of exponential increase. And also cutting. So from this standard pair, you get images, a lot of other unstable curves and densities on it. So this was our original W rho, I denoted, and you get a lot. Now, the first property which I show here, that if you take a function on your phase space, you want to evaluate the expected value of this function after n iteration of the map. Then one learns at school the law of total probability. So this expected value can be calculated in the following way. You take all the images of this given standard pair, so all the unstable curves and the densities on them, and calculate on all this L alpha n standard pair, the expected value of your function. And there are weights. The weights are given by how the original weight decomposes into the smaller pieces. So this is the law of total probability. And then the Markovity of the whole thing. This is reflected in the Gross lemma. This says that there are some constants such that for every epsilon, if, so W, this is the length of your unstable curve. So if you wait sufficiently long for every n larger than this thing, then the sum of weights corresponding to short standard pairs in the image. Oops, what happened? Yeah, it's here. Is short. And this is very good because those which are short for the time being you neglect, and you know how much, what is the total weight of those you neglect. So believe me that this is the main important, the most important part of Markowitz. And then in this equation, you have a newborn standard pair forgetting about the past. This is the Markowitz actually. Now, I want to show you what is the difference between Chernov-Dolgopyat model, where they apply this method very successfully, the standard pairs, and this problem which I am talking about. So in Chernov and Dolgopyat case, you have a disk of mass, a heavy disk, this red one, and you have scatterers. Again, the shaded circle is on the torus. It's a fixed scatterer. And you also have a point particle, and the two particles move, and they have elastic reflection. And this is a billiard. What was helpful for them, that if the mass of this moving disk is very large, then the unstable cone, the cones in general of the complete system are very close to the cones, invariant cones, of the two-dimensional billiard. So for a short time, this heavy disk almost does not move. So for the small particle, this is almost a Sinai billiard with two scatterers on the picture. The blue one is the fixed scatterer, and for a short time, the red one is also a scatterer, and you can use the nice stochastic properties of two-dimensional billiards. Now, in the Gaspar-Gilbert model, the problem is that the effect of collisions is very strong, so that you cannot approximate the unstable cones of the Gaspar-Gilbert model. They are far from those of two-dimensional Sinai billiard. There is an additional problem which I will not address. So this is, I repeat that I am considering two moving disks in this Gaspar-Gilbert model, and we would like to do something. Now, since there is no theory for four-dimensional semi-dispersing billiards, therefore, one has to do something different. And the first step, we simplified the model by taking a piston model, and if I succeed, I will show you the piston. So this is a piston model on the plane. In our case, we will only be interested in a quasi one-dimensional chain. You see that there are these piston particles which move on their interval here and there, and there are the disk particles which occasionally interact with the... Actually, this movie was done by Thomas Gilbert, one of the creators of this Gaspar-Gilbert model. So this is our model, and it's a three-dimensional billiard, also semi-dispersing, and okay. Now, this is a small technical problem that in this model, the two pieces of the boundaries make a corner, and if one wants, then one can replace this model with another model where instead of this diamond, you take the hyperbolic space and an octagon in it and take a billiard in it, and then you can couple it also with a piston, with a piston particle. I don't go into detail. Later it will be clear why I mentioned this. So this is, again, the, just one cell of this piston model, so one diamond and one piston coupled to it. So this is the diamond billiard phase space, and this is the complete phase space for the diamond and the piston. Now, so here I formulate the theorem. I don't want to get lost in all the notations. I just tell you that I'm interested in this two-particle model in the energy of the first particle, of the billiard particle, and this is what I denote by E. Then dynamics is, the flow is phi, corresponding to epsilon, so this is just the energy of the billiard particle at time t under the flow. And of course, I have to rescale it because the as epsilon tends to zero, the interactions are more and more rare. And of course, since this region where there is interaction, it has area, one area epsilon squared, that's why the proper scaling is time is t over epsilon squared. And then the theorem says that for a wide class of initial laws, the energy of the billiard particle in the appropriate scaling converges to a Markov jump process with some kernel, with some kernel. And here is the kernel, that's, so it's calculated. Actually, just for a short remark, that this piston model, so the diamond, and it's actually a billiard in this three-dimensional domain. So you have this cylinder, and for the interaction, you cut out this lower corner, which has height epsilon. So this is the billiard. Now, I would like to talk about one part of the proof, and this part of the proof tells about the following. So we have a standard pair, and so Chernoff had the following theorem for two-dimensional billiards, Sinai billiards, Lorentz process billiards for the same. You take two functions, which are nice so-called generalized Hölder functions. One of them has mean zero. Then this correlation decays stretched exponentially with some constants, which depends on the function. So this is the stretched exponential decay. Now, since we are applying standard pairs method, I want to emphasize that here, the average is taken with respect to the invariant measure, the Liouville measure. Since we are using standard pair method, we need a similar statement when the initial measure is singular, is given on a standard pair. So it's a curve and a probability density on it. So this is our formulation of the theorem. So you take a standard pair, phi tilde is the measure given by the standard pair, so it's in the complete phase space a measure determined by this density on the standard pair. And then you take the average of your function after time t with respect to this measure, and you have, again, a stretched exponential bound. So this is our theorem. And, well, I will tell you some words about the proof of the theorem to show that I was listening to the school part of the meeting. I learned that the method we are applying is actually Margulis thickening method. And to show it how it works is the following, that our phase space for the flow is three-dimensional. And here is the standard pair, W U. It's the curve, and you have to imagine a probability density on it. Now, since this is a singular measure, you have to somehow make it smooth. And this is what one does in the following way. I mean, you have the curve. First, you take, for example, in the center of the unstable curve, a disk, which is orthogonal for simplicity to this unstable curve in the center. So this is the disk D. And then first, it's easy to shift your unstable curve to every point of D. And then you get this nice picture, which is on the figure. However, you have also to do something. You also need, in hyperbolic theory, this is said, you need to work with the central stable manifolds. They are two-dimensional, central stable, meaning stable manifolds, and the flow direction. This is the central stable. And these are surfaces, and they behave like they are on the figure. They are, of course, not parallel. Moreover, since this is a singular dynamical system, some central stable manifolds are very short, close to the singularities of the BR. They can be very short. Nevertheless, we want to use this structure, and we use this structure in the following way, that, so this I said that D is a disk of radius epsilon. Yes, and this is, I already said that these are the shifted variants. And now let me focus on this so-called CS foliation, central stable foliation. First, I take those points on my original unstable curve. So the picture is like that, that I had this original unstable curve. In the center, I took the disk of radius epsilon. Then I shifted this unstable every direction. And there are other central stable manifolds. They can be short. So my first job is to worry about the measure of the sufficiently long unstable curves. So each is the set of those points of my original unstable curve where the central stable manifold crosses completely this U. U is the product of my unstable, so of my unstable curve with this D. And from classical Billiard theory, we know that the measure of sufficiently long central stable curves is, So each is the set of good points, and then the measure of the bad points is at most epsilon. So this we know from classical Billiard theory. Then the similar bound will hold on every, on shifted versions of the unstable curve, so that's very nice. And altogether, we will know that if we denote by U naught the set covered with good central stable, so good points are in H, and for every point of H, we take the corresponding central stable curve. Well, X should be downstairs, sorry, but I am saying in words. Then the bad set in U, in this sausage, is small. And, I think when I started?
7 minutes.
7 minutes. Oh, that's perfect. Thank you very much. So, now I do the following. So in the sausage, so I have this sausage. And it may have some gaps. There are sufficiently long central stable manifolds, and there are also others. And what I want to take, product. So I want to take the, yes, I think I. So mu tilde is the Liouville measure restricted to U. U is this sausage. And this measure can be decomposed as the product of two things. The factor measure on every central stable manifold, I remind you that central stable manifolds, there are shorter one and there are nice one which cross completely my sausage. So J is the index set for all the central stable manifolds, and H is the index set for the nice. And I will be interested only in the nice one, so we can forget about the other one. So I just, I will use this for H. And the essential thing is the following, that first of, so what I will do is that on this original W, I have a probability density, phi. Moreover, on the disk D, so this is the disk in the center D, I take a very beautiful probability density. And essentially what I want to do, I want to take the product of this density phi and the density given on this disk D. The density on D, the radius is epsilon, don't forget. So the density will be something like that. So this is 2 epsilon. And I want it to have a probability density. So it's natural that I have these bounds for the supremum of the probability density and its derivative. And I assume that both Q and the derivative vanishes outside D. And from these two things, I create a measure in this the smooth measure in this sausage. So this is the definition, that I introduce a measure by using phi and by using the density Q. And the density of this created measure will be d rho divided by d mu. Mu is the Liouville measure. And what I want to say that in the construction, of course, I cannot go into the detail, but there is one important element, that if I take a fixed sufficiently long, xd belongs to h, if I take a sufficiently long, a nice central stable manifold, then the integral of this G naught density with respect to the conditional density, I have to go back, so, oh, sorry. So in this decomposition, so this was the factor density, nu was the conditional measure on every central stable manifold, and this is what I have to use, that on every nice central stable manifold, integrating with respect to the conditional density on this central stable manifold, integrating this G naught, which I created, as I said you before, it's a very nice constant. Phi is the density given originally on the standard pair, phi. And beta is the derivative of the factor density with respect to the arc lengths. And this formula makes it possible to evaluate the integrals which figure in the theorem, and this makes it possible to apply this kind of Margulis thickening method. Well, this is a technical thing. So I think I finished by some remarks. So I talked here about one part of the proof, about how to prove this correlation decay for standard pairs. Of course, there are other parts of the proof, because I just mentioned one piece. So you have this model, and you have the piston particle. So interaction occurs when the billiard particle and the piston particle meet. They can only meet in this critical region. Now, for the composed model, the energy of the billiard particle on an unstable curve is not constant, because the composed model is a composed model. So, and even if it's constant, the energy after one collision, the energy will change along the outgoing curve, because there is an interaction, and it's a drastic interaction, it changes. So one has to handle also this question, but probably another time we can talk also about it. To close, I want to say that once one can prove the result for the model which I mentioned, it's almost automatic to get it of n cells. So it's not a real difficulty. The real difficulty is, of course, to get to the original Gaspar Gilbert model, to two-dimensional interacting. I don't know. Okay, so thank you very much.